behavioural economics is it takes on the standard economist's view of people being perfectly rational mathematical machines, and behavioural economics takes that on to say that people are boundedly rational, that information, cognitive constraints and other ways in which we think about things constrain decision making. The second thing about behavioural economics is that we are social animals. So standard economics assumes that we're self-interested, but we've evolved to be very socially aware, and so we interact with one another in all sorts of ways. So the second thing about behavioural economics that connects with that is that we have social preferences. For example, we don't like to see inequality, unequal outcomes, whether we're suffering them ourselves or we're seeing someone else suffering them. So the banker sees a beggar on the street, either way, it's not something that we want to see. The third thing about behavioural economics that connects with the fact that we're social animals as well is that we learn socially. So, for example, if you're seeing a queue for a long queue for a bar and there's a bar next door with no queue at all, often we will assume that the crowd, that the queue knows something that we don't, and so we will join that queue. And it means that we might have reason, a friend might have told us that the other bar was actually quite good, but we ignore that. And so all that private information about how good that bar without the queue might be gets lost. And so we follow, we herd along behind others. The fourth thing about behavioural economics is that we are motivated by things other than money. And so behavioural economists and economic psychologists talk about intrinsic versus extrinsic motivations. So extrinsic motivations are the motivations that come from outside us, and money would be one of them. Punishments would be another. But behavioural economists would argue that we're also motivated by intrinsic motivations, such as the desire to do a good job, pride in our work, all those sorts of things. And once we acknowledge that these motivations and incentives are more complex, it helps us to understand far better how workplaces operate, for example. The fifth thing about behavioural economics is its focus on the fact that we decide quickly. So standard economics assumes that we use a lot of information, we think quite carefully about the decisions that we make, but in reality, we are often constrained. We have to decide quickly, or we may be faced with a wide range of choices or a lot of information, and that it's all very confusing for us. The sixth thing about behavioural economics, which links into this quick thinking idea, is work by Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky. So Daniel Kahneman's famous for his book popularising some of these ideas, Thinking Fast and Slow. And so the idea is, with quick thinking, it's using heuristics, it's using rules of thumb to enable us to decide quickly. But the trouble with using these heuristics is that people make mistakes. And that happens particularly in the context of risk. We're not very good at risky decision making. So there's various discontinuities or various irregularities in the way we decide when we're facing risk that's not captured very well by standard economics. We're not very good at forward planning, and so we suffer from present bias. So that doesn't mean that we're impatient, it means we're disproportionately impatient in the short term. The eighth thing about behavioural economics, in standard economics to an extent, though I'm simplifying a bit, individual differences are neglected. Now, in modern economics, people, you know, economists would allow that differences in age or gender, socio-demographic characteristics, they can have an influence. But generally, the role of personality, moods and emotions are not allowed in standard economics. And this is a particularly fascinating area of behavioural economics because it's allowing that different personality types affect how people decide and choose. The ninth thing about behavioural economics is that behavioural economics is not well designed for capturing macroeconomic behaviour, because behavioural economics assumes that people might be interdependent, they might learn from each other, all these personality and individual differences, all these sorts of things make it very difficult to aggregate. And the point about standard macroeconomic models is they've got the aggregation problem really solved. If you assume that everyone's the same, you just add every individual up, you've got your macroeconomy. But in behavioural macroeconomics, that's a lot more complicated because people are interacting, people are different. And so in terms of the behavioural macroeconomics, that's one of the big challenges for behavioural economics, is to capture behavioural macroeconomics more effectively. The tenth thing about behavioural economics is it's very useful to policymakers. So Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein wrote the pioneering book Nudge, all about how policymakers can use nudges to change behaviour. And there are various nudges that people use, or policymakers can use, and a very widely used one is default options.